5, 4.
Hello, my name is Terry Carter. I'm here today to have a conversation with Barbara Pritchard Fear, who is a native of Newmarket and has...
Try not to wrestle the paper.
Okay.
That's all I'm picking up right now.
Hello, my name is Terry Carter. I'm here to have a conversation this morning with Barbara Pritchard Fear, a native of Newmarket who has retained her interest, although she hasn't lived here for a long time, retained her interest in the town, and she has many recollections of Newmarket over many years. Shall I say that?
Barb, Terry, just don't tell them how many.
No. Barb, you grew up in Newmarket. Tell us about your earliest memories of the town. Where were you living when you were a child?
We lived at 35 Lorne Avenue, which is now number 208. And at that time, it was sort of on the western edge of the town. It was almost getting into suburbs, if there were such a thing in those years. So it was a delightful spot. My dad built that home, and we lived in it. I lived in it until I was married, and then we bought our own home later on. But it was a wonderful area because we had a great bunch of chums that played. There were the three Barbaras on Lorne Avenue. There was Barbara Binns and Barbara Gilroy, who was the granddaughter of Alexander Muir, myself, and there was the Baileys, Catherine and John Bailey. There was Ken Hunter. There was Melfort McCaffrey, and it was just a great, we were all about the same age. It was just wonderful.
You've covered your playmates, but what do you remember about the rest of the neighborhood around Timothy and Botsford?
Well, on Timothy Street, I used to be able, until recent years, just go up one street and down the other and name everybody that I remembered that lived there. Across the corner, the police chief, the Kirk family, lived across the corner. And down a little farther, there was Mrs. Rogers, and she was who we called the squirrel lady. She used to feed the squirrels, and the street would be covered with nutshells, and the squirrels would sit out and wait for her to come and feed them. And just next to her were the Pifers. And as you mentioned, Bill Pifer, who was our first first victim of World War II. He was shot down. I believe he was a pilot.
Bomber pilot, yes.
And he was more of a contemporary of my brother Jack. I remember Dorothy, his sister, more than I remembered Bill. And then there was, of course, Ina Hall, who was Ina McHale, but it was Ina Hall, and her father was a policeman on the Newmarket force. And then there was Mr. Sennett, who had a wonderful garden. We all admired Mr. Sennett's garden, but he only had one chair on his big veranda. That way, if you stopped to talk to him, he wasn't going to invite you to sit down. He didn't want to waste time because he wanted to be with his garden.
Yeah.
And actually then there was Ivan Atkins, who was another flyer who was shot down during the Second World War. But I could name all the people in that area, but we really don't have time for that, I don't think. But my memories are very happy of that area. The McElroys and a couple of school principals lived next door to us at different times, and Charles Boyd's family. And of course the McCaffreys, and they were office specialty friends of mother and dad too. So it was a wonderful neighborhood. And the Binses, Mrs. Binns used to play the piano a lot. And when we were kids, Barbara would take us over there so we could sit and listen to their mother play the piano, and I loved that.
Do you remember Elisha Goodman, who lived on the corner of Park and Lorne and was a concert pianist?
Yes, I do.
But he used to practice Sunday mornings, and we'd all go and sit on the sidewalk and listen.
Oh, Terry, that's interesting, because I know Gloria Goodman went to school with me.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah. So, yes, and it's the whole area, as I say, I could name them all, practically.
Bill Pifer, the news that Bill had been lost came the day his sister was to be married. Do you remember anything about that horrible day?
Terry, I don't, because I think it was at the start of the war, and that would be 39 or 40, and I was only 7 or 8, believe it or not. You know, I mean, I'm wrong, even at that. So I'm sorry, no, I don't. Probably my parents knew about the catastrophe, because it would be a real tragedy to have that happen. But as I say, I remember Dorothy, and I don't know whether she taught Sunday school or something at the United Church where I was brought up. Mm-hmm. I can't remember. But Bill, as I said, was more of a contemporary, my brother Jack, who was 8 years older than I.
Wow.
Yeah.
Your family has deep roots in this area. Talk a bit about your parents and your grandparents and farther back, and tell us about your grandfather's farms near Sharon.
Well, yes, my family, the Doan side of the family, which is connected, as you know, to the Sharon Temple, goes back to 1804 in the area.
Wow.
Here. Yes, they came from Pennsylvania and northern New York State, and some from Vermont after the American 1776 revolution.
So they were UELs.
Well, really? They weren't really. That you could think
late,
of
late
them
UELs.
As yes, because they were actually Quakers, and I don't know whether they were ever equated with UELs. That's the funny part of it. I've never seen it in any of the documentation of the Doans.
Yeah.
So whether they just preferred to remain separate or not, I don't know, because of being Quakers, I don't know.
You had to serve in a loyalist military unit in those days to be a UEL, and the Quakers would not have done that, so
no.
Probably they came on their own.
Yes, I think they did, Terry, actually. Amos Armitage bought, or at least was accorded, about 8,000 acres of land between the northern border of Toronto and, you know, up Yonge Street, and they received free land at the time. So that's mother's side of the family, and as I was telling Terry earlier, it's not a terribly exclusive club, because it's a registered corporation. The Doan family is a registered corporation in the United States. And it's interesting that they really didn't follow their history much other than with men. Women were left completely out of the
story.
Chain. Yes, which affronted me terribly. Anyway, and my father, it's 100 years this year since my father came to Newmarket.
Really?
1912.
And where did he
He came to work. He came here from Lucknow. His family were Welsh from the Carnarvon area of Wales. And his father was a miller. And he built two mills in Huron County, not far, sort of between Kincardine and Lucknow and a place called Ripley, which was just sort of a crossroads. But there was a school there. And so my father's family settled near Ripley, actually, where the mills were, of course. And then they moved, after they closed the mills, they moved to Lucknow. And Dad came to Newmarket from Lucknow to work at Office Specialty, where he was for over 50 years. Nobody does that anymore, do they?
No. And what was his role in the specialty?
He was head of the credit department, actually. Yes, he was an accountant, and he kept track of the ingoings and outcomings, or whatever, of the accounting for Office Specialty Manufacturing, which was amazing to have Office Specialty, Dixon's, and Davis's, three major manufacturing corporations and companies in such a small area, small town of about 4,000 people at the time they all ended up in Newmarket.
Yeah.
The specialty came to Newmarket, actually, in about the latter part of the 19th century.
Yes.
So in fact, they had so much work that they were begging for people to move to Newmarket to have work in the factories and so on. But no, Dad, the interesting thing now, my grandfather Flanagan, who was on my mother's side, his brother Peter owned a hotel here in Newmarket, right at the corner of Davis Drive and Main Street.
Yeah. That gray house they're going to move pretty soon to make way for the subway or whatever they're building.
Really? Something else is going to disappear?
It's
going to
move back on the lot, that's all.
Oh, right, because it's got an 1898 or something.
Yeah.
plaque on the front of it.
It says Union Hotel, I think.
I was trying to remember, and I did have it in some of my research, but I didn't have time to sort of get it all there. But Grandpa Flanagan, as you mentioned, my mother's father, he was married to a Doan, and that's that connection, of course. And they had a beautiful dairy farm, Holstein's, just north of Sharon, next adjacent and property adjacent to the Doan farm, Ebenezer's farm, sorry. And I used to go there for my summer holidays sometimes, but I was such a dweeb. I would get homesick after about 3 or 4 days and want to come back to Newmarket. I don't know. Anyway, there must be something there that's still in the psyche, Terry, because I'm still coming back to Newmarket. Anyway, it was a very historic part of the world because that's where the Children of Peace, the offshoot of the Quakers, ended up with David Wilson and the Sharon Temple, which is still a wonderfully important landmark in our Canadian history, and too few people know about it. I was in a writing workshop for about 6 years in Kingston after I left Barrie, and I was appalled at the number of, well, there were a number of retired profs from Queens, never ever heard of the Sharon Temple, never heard of Sharon, so I had a wonderful time proselytizing my head off as much as I could, teaching them about what Central Ontario and north of Toronto was really about. And so that's the connection with Grandpa Flanagan, married my a Grandma Doan, at least it was a Doan, and became Grandma Flanagan, and all tied up with the Sharon Temple. Hmm.
You lived up the street from two of the three public schools Newmarket had in our day,
mm-hmm.
Stuart Scott, which was two blocks away, I guess, one block away from your house, and King George, which was two blocks away. Which one did you go to, or did you bounce back and forth as they changed the boundaries?
It was interesting, really. It was so handy to go to Stuart Scott when I first started school. Now, I went down there, and I can think of Miss Brammer, and, of course, Harold Jackson, who was the principal of the public schools at the time, that were teachers. I don't know. I think I went to Stuart Scott for about 4 years and then shifted over to King George School on Park Avenue. And I must have been there for about 3 or 4. I did I did 2 years in one. I think it was 4 and 5, but I'm not sure. So that meant that I guess I went to high school from King George School, because I wasn't in another one, because Alexander Muir was cross town, as you know. So then you were shifted around too, as well.
Well, I lived on the south side of Timothy Street, and they kept changing the school boundaries depending on how many kids had registered at each school. So one year I'd be in one school, and one year in another, and I soon got to know everybody.
Yeah, well, that's quite true. You do after a while. But that was as much as I could remember, and then starting high school, because I was 12 when I started high school. I'd be 13 in the following December. But I don't think there was another grade other than 7 and 8 as well at King George. It must have been like 5, 6, 7, and 8 or something.
When I went up to 7 at Stuart Scott, and you had to go to King George for 8.
Right.
And
okay.
Jackson himself taught that.
Yes. And I can thank him for creating my love of English and grammar. He just drilled us like a drill sergeant all the time, and I just fell in love with English. And I guess that accounts for my love of writing and journalism and research and all that sort of thing, Terry, and I'm sure it's the same for you if you had him.
I had him, and I had Miss Denny at the other school. So
between
the two of them, I got well drilled.
Yes, you would. Yes, Evelyn Denny, she was an interesting lady. But the Jackson family, they were friends of Mother and Dad's. I think they were friends of a lot of people, mm-hmm. like your own family as well. But I always thanked him for that, and I was thinking there was Mr. Forbes, and there was a Miss Hambly, and there was a Mr. Darling, who was very ill named, because one time we had a spelling contest, and I was good in spelling, thank heaven, because he strapped everybody that had one mistake in spelling at this particular contest. And I thought, You're not really Mr. Darling, you're Mr. Mean. I never forgot that. I thought, I was just lucky I could spell. Anyway, with Mr. Jackson, as I say, he was he was a hard taskmaster. There was no question about that. He was a very strong disciplinarian, and he made sure that we learned what he taught. I think,
he did,
Terry,
yeah.
You find that.
Yes.
And one of the things, excuse me, that I liked was music, and Mrs. Selden, we used to have music once a week. And which was, you know, these days I don't suppose that even happens.
No, I don't suppose it does.
But no, but
I remember Ma Selden.
Yes, that's right. And she used to come in once a week, and we'd have music and so on, go from there. And as I say, we had a lot of fun when we were singing, because that was a real break.
Yeah, music and the arts have always played a big part in your life. Tell us a little about your involvement. Through the years.
Oh, Terry. Well, it's been kind of endless, and music's been awfully good to me. I studied piano, like so many kids, fellow-aged kids, when we were chums and so on and so forth, but I studied piano, and in high school I was in the Glee Club, and Ada Lund Jamison was our Glee Club music teacher in high school. Loved that. I sort of shudder at this because things have changed so much, but a number of us were in the Lions Club minstrel shows, too, in Newmarket that were so hugely successful.
They were.
Weren't they? 5 nights they'd put on this the Lions Club minstrel shows. And it was Dick Hilliard and Ang West and, of course, Jack Lusby. And, you know, all these people that I remember so well, and we had such a whale of a time, and the community really was so receptive of those minstrel shows. But these gays, of course, and we didn't do it in a derogatory way at all. I don't recall that. I know it's something that is not done anymore, but the music was so wonderful, and this, you know, the Stephen Foster things, and we had Terry Doan and Murray Huntley, who were such wonderful singers. Mm-hmm. And you know, it was fun, and it was done with a lot of respect, I think, relative to the fact that it was minstrels. And then in high school, and in ballet, Mrs. Belugan, whose husband Alec Belugan was mayor at one point.
Yes,
in time,
he was.
She used to have a dancing class, and my mother enrolled me in Mrs. Belugan's ballet class. The unfortunate thing is, I wanted to tap dance, so I liked Ann Miller and Eleanor Powell, and I wanted to tap dance, but I had the ballet, and you know. Anyway, dear mother, she did her best, as mothers do, you know. So, and also in high school, of course, there were the Pickering College operettas. I wasn't in one during the time I was in high school. I was too busy with other things at the time. But I did go into Patience a year or so after I had graduated. So I was in Patience. I was Lady Ella in Patience. Had a lovely time, and it was such fun to do that music, which is such fun.
That's Gilbert and Sullivan.
Gilbert and Sullivan, yes.
Bob Rourke's.
Oh, yes. Bob Rourke was just always marvelous.
He was the headmaster at Pickering, and was a fanatic about Gilbert and Sullivan, wasn't he?
Wasn't he?
He insisted they put it on every year.
Exactly. And his wife was an opera singer, so
yeah.
She always played one of the major roles. And Alice, she was wonderful, beautiful singer. And Fred Hagen used to do the sets. And Dennis Burton, who became very well known as Artists 11 or whatever in Toronto after that, and he did a lot of the sets with Fred Hagen. So it was a very professional approach to it. There was nothing amateurish about it. It was really, unless it was me, it was wonderfully well done. And so music, yes, that's true, and always loved it. Music's been very good to me in many ways, Terry, too. I'll tell you more about that later. So.
Well, Newmarket High was the only secondary school in town when you and I were growing up, so that's obviously where you went.
Obviously.
And you probably walked to school the same as the rest of us.
But I didn't bicycle.
You didn't bicycle.
Oh, and it was uphill all the way
and
downhill all the way back.
Yeah.
But yes, I figured it was a mile from our homes
At least, because I always figured a mile and a tenth from where we lived on Timothy Street, and so you'd be the other tenth.
Yeah, it'd be the other tenth. Yes, that's true. And I think we were all pretty fit, you know, and of course we had lots of PT. At which time, something came up the other day somewhere I was, and they were talking about waltzing and what a lovely dance waltzing is. And I said, yes, in high school, our gym teacher taught the girls how to waltz, but none of the boys knew how to waltz. So when the big bands came along and played a waltz, well, we didn't do anything. But anyway, it was a good way to keep fit, Terry, when we walked from home and usually took lunch. And quite often I walked home for lunch because my father worked at Office Specialty right at the corner of Prospect and Gorham, or at least was Timothy Street, I think, at that time where the office was. And Dad would often, I mean, he usually walked back and forth for lunch. Actually, it was dinner at noon, too, in those times.
Yeah.
Quite often. And so we were all pretty fit and slim in those days. But I loved high school. I was very active in sports. I loved volleyball. I loved basketball. Track and field, because I had long legs, I was good at the high jumping. I loved doing that when I didn't, you know. I won a few ribbons for that. And certainly, one of the things that I really found was so wonderful was we started in grade 13. As we started grade 13, a group of us started the Newmarket High School paper, the blue and the gold. It was the first newspaper since way before the war. It was about 48, 49 when we graduated, so that was about the year 49 when we put that first newspaper together, and it was a real bestseller for 2 cents. It really was. And Reed Bell, I think, was he was the literary rep, and I was the editor, and it was quite successful. And when I think back, Terry, it's so amazing, because from little seeds, big things grow. And I know that there's a wonderful school magazine, high school magazine, I'm sure now, yearbook, isn't
there?
Yeah,
I think it is, yeah.
I would think so, yeah. So
the newspaper was still going some years later, I know, and probably still going.
Oh, isn't that interesting? Yeah. A school newspaper.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's nice to know that, you know, it was our love of writing, and Esther McGee was so marvelous at encouraging us. And, you know, a lot of fun times, and we had people from every grade, every year that we could possibly involve to write on something, whether it was the Literary Society, the Glee Club, all the sports departments and that sort of thing. So we involved as many of the kids as we could. And so that was sort of the final high school year in Newmarket. And at that time, I should add that I had the honor of being the Simpsons Collegiate Club representative from Newmarket. There was an Eaton's Eaton's Junior Council, I think it was, and the Simpsons Collegiate Club, and these two big department stores involved young people from the high schools as far out as Newmarket, which was really pretty far out. Man, at that time.
In those days, we weren't a suburb, we were a farm town.
We were a farm town, that's right, Terry. Anyway, it was a lot of fun, and it was a wonderful opportunity to come down and meet a lot of the city kids, who made us really feel very welcome. We were all part of the same group, the Simpsons group, and we'd have an opportunity to model in the fashion shows, and we had an opportunity to work in Simpsons for, I think it was Easter week, that they and we were given a beautiful suit of clothes, I had a gray wool, pure wool suit that they gave me to wear when I was going to be working in the store in Toronto. So it was an interesting experience, business-wise, and also to kind of get out of the country feeling and into the big city. It was a lot of fun.
Any special teachers at high school you recall particularly?
Yes, I do, very much so. I think more than anyone, Esther McGee Otten. Esther was my teacher with English, of course, again, English teacher. And I just loved, with Shakespeare, I think I memorized Macbeth and Hamlet. I practically memorized all those two books. I just absolutely loved it. She was a wonderful teacher, and she just, I don't know, she was one of my favorites, like Mr. Jackson. Mm-hmm. And so I can thank her in so many ways for giving me my love of writing and the usual thing, as I've said before, Terry. And Ada Lunn, who married Charlie Jameson, she was the music teacher. And when they were courting, the kids gave them a really tough time, as kids in high school will do. Oh, here she comes, here he comes, you know, on and on. It was, they were always teased by the staff, and certainly the students anyway. And I especially remember her, and I remember, I was trying to think, Mr. Lockhart, of course. They called him Duke Lockhart. Did you have Duke Lockhart?
I did, yeah. He was the principal when I attended.
When you were there too, Terry, yes. I think you were, what, 4 years behind me?
I think I was. You were graduating the year I got there.
That you got there, yeah. Yes, okay. So Mr. Lockhart, he was, I liked him. I thought he was a nice man, and I didn't give him any trouble. And he didn't give me any trouble, thank goodness. And he encouraged us very much with the newspaper. He really did. He came out on behalf of us and our efforts and felt that it was a really good sort of business exercise and the importance of hitting deadlines and involving people and their opinions and so on in the newspaper. And I liked Mr. Lockhart very much. I don't think there were any teachers in high school that I didn't like. I loved, there was dear history teacher, I'm trying to think of.
I had Esther McGee for history.
Oh, did you
so
have Esther?
Help you there.
Oh, right, okay. I'll think of it maybe eventually. I can see her picture when she retired. And I must say, I had no love for history at that time because what basically we had to learn were all the kings of England and English history. I don't even recall that we learned much American history, and certainly we didn't learn a lot of Canadian history.
No, hardly any.
No.
In high school, mostly in elementary school.
That's right. If there was any history at all, it was in elementary school, Terry. That's true. And so I really wasn't terribly keen on it. I came across my graduation certificates the other day when I was bringing some things here to the museum. And I thought, I could have done better, but I was so busy with so many other things in grade 13, particularly, with the newspaper and the sports and actually the collegiate club, getting back to that just briefly, because of being our last year, and I was involved with the Simpsons Collegiate Club, I asked if they would bring one of their city orchestras to our graduation. A dance, our prom, final prom dance, and I think it was in May of 49. So they did, and we had Benny Lewis from Toronto at our final prom, graduation prom, and that was a real coup. We were thrilled about that. I've still got the invitations and so on that, you know, I seem to have a penchant for saving things now and then. So, I loved high school, and we had a good group. We had the mischief makers, of course, in our room. Ken Budd, who was one of the leaders of it. Dunk Beatty, who was a delight. And Stallard Waterhouse. And those are the three that, you know, got everybody in trouble and just drove the, you know, threw the inkwells out the door, out the window and things like this. Oh, I can remember it just. So the teachers really had a trial at times with us all, I think.
With everybody. Yeah. But it was a small school. There were, 400 students, maybe?
Oh, probably.
600 at most.
Yes. How many thousand are in the new one?
A couple of thousand now.
Really?
Yeah,
probably?
Must be a different school community altogether.
Yes, and the fact that you wouldn't get to know as many people. I mean, we knew everybody. We knew all the kids because we were all, and even the kids that came from Keswick on the bus. Mm. You know, I think of those kids, they must have been on the bus at 7:30 in the morning from Keswick to drive down to Newmarket, and there was just one bus that I recall.
Yeah.
And to me, you know.
When we had a snowstorm, they all had to stay in town.
Yeah,
and everybody
right.
had to billet somebody.
That's right, and that was fun, and that's how you got to know each other.
Yeah.
So I did have a lot of fun with a friend, a school friend, Ruth Mary Winch, and her family were in Keswick. And every now and then I'd go on the bus with her for a weekend, and she'd come down to my place and or stay at my place for a weekend. And if there was a snowstorm, she knew where she could be staying. And the irony, Terry, was the fact, too, that our mothers knew each other years ago when they were young women. And yeah, and it was really so amazing that Ruth Mary's mother and my mother had known each other way back when at some point. So then the second generation took over.
Yeah.
But no, it was interesting.
Well, we really were a small town. I mean, Newmarket was under 4,000, and
yes, it was.
And the surrounding communities were all tiny, and so there was a lot of interaction.
Excuse me.
Main Street was the only place to shop. There were no malls, no plazas.
No.
Talk a bit about living in a small
what
town
it was
as
like
opposed
then.
To yeah, opposed to now.
Well, you know, I often laugh and I think and say on a Saturday night what we would do on a Saturday night. And of course, when the army camp was here, that was a bit different too. Our parents were a little stricter, I think.
Mm-hmm, I think so.
But generally speaking, before the army camp came along, but that was in most of our high school years that they were. It was over in 45. But we used to just get together. We'd go downtown, have a milkshake, maybe at Hillsdale Dairy if it was still open. And we'd often just get together and walk up and down Main Street and have, a milkshake. A lot of the kids would come home to my place and we'd listen to records. Those were the days of the 78s and the big band era, which everybody enjoyed. And then we'd have, you know, the odd private party when there was a particular event. And, of course, our parents were there.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. They didn't take off for the evening when the party started. But it was, and at school, high school, too, there were quite often special events, whether it would be on a Friday evening, like a tea dance in the afternoon after classes, or a sock hop, we used to call it, and in the gym, because you couldn't wear shoes in the gym, so we just wear our socks and be able to dance. But listening to records was one of the main things. But there was a group of us that, you know, they'd say, what are you doing Saturday night? Oh, not very much. Well, why don't we go downtown and have a milkshake or someplace at one of the restaurants? And they always made us feel welcome. We pretty well behaved ourselves. And after school, quite often, at Hillsdale Dairy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a place. And Mr. McCappen was very kind and tolerant of us, sitting around talking and drinking his milkshakes. But I remember those names. I remember, who was it? Mr. Clemson that used to deliver milk.
Deliver milk for Newmarket
yes,
Dairy.
Yeah,
I remember George Clemson.
George, that's right. Yeah, thinking of all these different times. And Riddles used to deliver bread.
Riddles bread?
Yeah.
I still can taste that bread sometimes.
Oh,
the best bread.
Stuff.
Never had.
Yes, right. Oh, our happy memories of remembering these things. It's just hilarious. But the tea dances and sock hops and so on. I was trying to name some of the stores on Main Street, which you would remember too, Terry, and that going from the post office down to Bowser's, and then there was Morrison's Menswear, and then there was McNabb's Hardware, and there was Gilroy's Men's Store.
Yeah.
And then there was the Imperial Bank on the corner there, I think, for a while. And then there was the pool room, and of course I was warned to stay away from the pool room. You just don't go near the pool room, Barbara. I didn't know how to play pool anyway, you know. But and across the street, it's interesting when I walk down the street now and in my mind go through all these places, and there was the Bank of Montreal, which is comforting. It's still there
still
on the
there.
Corner.
Still there. It's one of the few landmarks left on Main Street.
Yes,
that's
it
right.
Is. Gee, that's comforting. It really is. And one of the things that I should tell you about, because it's just, and there was Gilroy's, and then Best Drugstore. I love that. Chester Best was his name,
yeah.
And it was called the Best Drugstore, which was a great play on words. And Elaine Robinson's parents had a lovely gift shop.
Yes.
On Main Street too. I remember
Marigold Shop. Is that what
Oh, that's it. That's it, Terry. The Marigold Shop. But I must tell you how things work out sometimes, because I was thinking about what we used to do in high school, say on a Saturday afternoon or a weekend. Recently, after 60 years of trying to find each other, a friend that I used to, that used to be in high school with me, Norma Jean Squires, she is a very internationally recognized artist living outside Santa Monica, California. And my friend Jean Webster and Barry, Jean Webster McFadgen, got us together a couple of falls ago. Thank goodness for email. I mean, this is one of the things that is great about it.
Yeah.
And anyway, she and I, as kids in high school, I loved to draw, too. I just loved to draw. And so did Jean. And we were chums. I didn't know her in public school. I don't know what school she went to, actually, but I didn't know her in public school. But in high school, quite often, we would get together on a Saturday afternoon and just draw, either at her place or at my place. And considering the fact that we've been trying to find each other for, believe it or not, Terry, 60 years, and we were so absolutely overwhelmed at finally finding each other, because she was apparently trying to locate where I might be too. And over the years, I heard different rumors about where she was, that she was in New York City and she was working for a radio station in New York City. And anyway, we've been able to fill in a lot of the blanks from when she left Newmarket High School. And I went to Dominion Business College, actually, in Toronto after I finished grade 13, Terry. And I spent a year there. It was a good school, too. My father thought I would come back being a comptometer operator in his department, maybe. Well, as it turned out, I became the secretary of Dr. Bob King, who was the first York County Health Unit. MOH, yeah, that's right. So, but, you know, email can be such an addiction, and it can be a curse, but this was the greatest blessing, I think, in all the years I've been on the computer.
So did the three of you actually get together?
Since?
Yeah.
Well, no, because she's been trying to get into up to Canada again and do a trip on the St. Lawrence River, because she and her husband had been planning this. And I said, well, if you get here, let me know. But we haven't, but we've filled in the blanks via email. I've got a file, a paper file, because I'm still back at paper, of all the things that she wrote and talked about, and we put together, the two of us. So we finally figured out what each of us had done after high school. That's how we lost track. She went to Toronto. She was working for one of the radio stations as a librarian in Toronto, and then carried that on to New York, and she, it was just amazing. That has been something I've never quite gotten over, as you can tell. It was a real thrill to meet Jeannie again. And she goes by Norma Jean, and I said, well, you're very timely, aren't you, you know? Norma Jean Monroe. Anyway, but as it turned out, she is an internationally acclaimed artist. She's been all over Europe with her work, and very, very gifted, and hasn't changed a whole heck of a lot either to look at. Just a beautiful woman. So anyway, there was something else when we were talking. Maybe you've got the answer to it. Oh, and I was going to Bowser's and Brunton's and Harry's Dry Goods.
Oh.
Remember? And Annie's restaurant, Resto's Fruit Market.
They're using that building as part of the new Civic Center, and they uncovered that Resto's Fruit sign from under the cladding last year, and so it was photographed before it was covered up again.
Photograph
in the inside the building, yeah.
Oh, because it was interesting to see it in your newsletter, and the Historical Society newsletters, Terry, are just simply wonderful. Better and better and better, just wonderful. And sometimes I save them, and I'm going to send a couple to Jean down and take them off or shoot them off to her so that she can read them too. Find out what's going on, because she's got a lot of memories too from her family lived just north of Davis Drive at the end of, just not far from the Newmarket Cemetery area.
Oh, yeah.
So, anyway, you wanted to know about work after.
After school, right? Or
yes.
Even during school.
During school, at high school.
Work in Newmarket when it's such a small town. I know it was always a problem finding a job for kids.
Well, it was, but my first one, and I don't know whether there was an age limit. I think there must have been, probably, but was Chainway.
Oh.
I was a clerk at Chainway for a while. and one summer, and thoroughly enjoyed that. I don't know whether there was an age limit that you couldn't work until you were 16 or something. I don't know. I think probably there might have been. Because after that, then my father got me into the office specialty. And I typed up invoices for the office specialty customers and so on. I spent a summer doing that. And I worked for Mr. Walter Stevens, who was a very lovely man, white hair, a very handsome man. And he loved to use a paper clip to clean out his ears while he was talking on the telephone. And I used to get such a kick out of me working away there and talking on the phone. And he was a dear man. He must have been very tolerant to have me in the department, too. But anyway, they stuck me at the typewriter, and that's where I was comfortable. So that worked out all right. Anyway, so those were my two summer jobs that I recall, Terry. Yeah. And we spent our summer holidays, Dad's holidays, at Island Grove Cottage, and had a lovely time there. And my school chums from Keswick area and all over the place, you know, in that area, they would come and we'd have fun at the cottage. So,
you got married not too long after you graduated, I think, but you still lived in Newmarket for quite a while, didn't you?
Yes, we lived in Newmarket. I was 35 when we left, and we were married in 52. And I worked for a couple of years for the York County Health Unit and Dr. King. And for some strange reason, I decided that I don't think I'm going to work now that I'm married. And Stan didn't object. So I became the constant canvasser in town. And I used to think that I'll bet when people would see me walking up the sidewalk, here she comes again, what's she canvassing for this time? But I did a lot of that, and I enjoyed it. And I also was one of the first members of the volunteer committee of York County Hospital, when it was York County Hospital, now South Lake. And Dr. Bill Noble's wife, Helen Noble, was the one, I believe, who started the volunteer committee at the hospital. So I spent some time there, thoroughly enjoyed that as well. And I felt it was valuable. It was really not as involved. I don't think there was a gift shop per se at that time, but there was this cart that we took around through all the wards and so on, and anybody that wanted magazines, and they were free. There were candy to be bought, and you know, that sort of thing, Terry. So it was nice. And I used to do, well, of course, then I started at the Era and Express, writing this incredible column around the town with Barbara Fear. And I loved doing it because I talked to everybody, yeah. And everybody would call me and tell me where they were going for the weekend, and who was graduating or who had been whatever. And I had to get a big kick out of it because our doctor was Dr. Gordon Koch. And he said to me one day, you know, I even read your Around the Town with Barbara Fear. Oh, dear, I had to laugh at that. And but I brought a column with me. I don't know whether you're into many visuals at the moment, but it was what was in this particular column. And anyway, I can leave it with you if you want to take a picture of it. But it was a lot of fun. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And then I did some special features for you. And one was the retirement of Mr. Jackson, our high school principal. Yeah. And at that time, I wrote the story of his retirement and his career. And I sort of shudder reading it now because having spent so much time trying to perfect my journalistic efforts, I could have written it much better now. But anyway, he was a wonderful man, and it was an honor to be able to do it after all that time because I was such an admirer of his and the family. And at the time that their son Alan died was a terrible catastrophe in a summer. He was an air cadet in the summer and crashed in an air.
Yeah, he was taking pilot training.
Where was I? Don't know. Was it maybe out west?
No, I believe it was down in eastern or western Ontario, down around St. Thomas somewhere. They had a base.
Was it, Terry? I didn't remember.
There anymore.
Yeah, but it was a terrible thing, and but anyway, I loved the writing, and even when we moved to Beaconsfield, Quebec, and it was a wonderful time to be in Quebec, 65 to 67,
oh, yes.
The last great years of Canada, somebody, Pierre Burton said. And anyway, I kept on and had some work published in the Montreal Gazette, some poetry, and also some letters to the editor that drew my ire because there was a marvelous shopping center not far from where we lived called Fairview, just north of Port, or at least Kirkland, I should say. And they imported this marvelous replica of David, Michelangelo's David,
mm-hmm.
and they set it up as a beautiful display in Fairview Mall Shopping Center. And it was so interesting to get the reactions of people who thought it was absolutely disgusting to have this nude David standing in the middle of a shopping center where all the children can see it. Well, that got my Irish up. I have a little Irish in me too. And I wrote a letter to the editor and said that, you know, this is great art and it's time for everybody to be able to approve or at least experience and understand what it's about, and the fact that they had done this tremendous chore of bringing this, you know, replica came from Italy. It was replicated over there and shipped over. And the newspaper picked it up, and then I had phone calls from the radio stations and so on. I was my 15 minutes of fame
in Montreal.
In Montreal. Oh dear, but I thought, oh my goodness, come on, realize this is the real world, folks, and it's a beautiful piece of work. Oh, the, you know, it was like, who am I thinking of? Walter Allward, that did the Vimy Memorial.
And the statue of the bust and the Haynes boy in Newmarket.
Yes, in Newmarket. I was so interested to see that, Terry, that it was Walter Allward,
mm-hmm.
because when I lived in the Barrie area and was involved up there, I was constantly going to Coochiching Park to see that magnificent statue of Champlain. And he was so marvelous. And I did a research thing, and he's done work across Canada too, and did some work in Victoria, I believe,
oh.
BC. I think there's something out there that he did, but I was so impressed to see that the Haynes Memorial was done by Walter Allward,
yeah.
because to me that Vimy Memorial is one of the greatest pieces of sculpture in all time, I think. And of course he did the National War Memorial in Ottawa.
Yes. Yeah.
So at least I think it was, wasn't it? Allward, and who was the other one? The Brit that did, no, it was Vernon March. Sorry, Vernon March, who did, I knew I was wrong there, because I did a lot of research. I've always thought that the War Memorial in Ottawa was one of the most handsome pieces of work, and it was Vernon March from England who did the one in Canada, and it was Walter Allward in Canada who did the one in France.
The one at Vimy, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah. So, anyway.
Well, Barb,
yeah.
although you live in Eastern Ontario, I don't think you've ever left Newmarket in your heart.
Doesn't sound like it, does it,
no.
Terry?
You've been a longtime contributor to a Historical Society newsletter, and you're going to continue, I'm sure.
I will do my best. I really, it's dear to my heart, and I love what you're doing, here, and how it's growing and developing, because there are a lot of people here that need to know
yeah.
the history of this town, and so many people who don't. And have never known really how important the town is and how important the Quakers were. I have to get this plug in,
that's
Terry.
Right. Yes, yes.
In settling and founding the town.
And the Offshoot, the Children of Peace, and bringing us responsible government.
Exactly.
If Wilson hadn't controlled that political machine.
That's right. Where would we be today?
We wouldn't have the votes there.
No, we wouldn't, Terry. This is quite true. And this is what I tried to send to the Beaver, but they weren't interested
yeah.
in it.
Well, can you think of anything we've missed in our hour of conversation about living in the town and about your relationship to the town?
Well, I don't know. I don't think we've missed too much. It's been interesting because, of course, I've had so many relatives who lived for a long time in town, too. My father was 90 when he died, and he, at the time, I think, was one of the longest living residents in the town, and that was in 1984. And so, I mean, I've always been back and forth, and still with the family buried up in Queensville Cemetery, my grandfather and grandmother Flanagan, who was a dome, and so on up there, and it was my second home too. So, I mean, there's such a connection there. It's like coming home in so many ways, except as I told you earlier, it seems at times like a strange land with all the things that are missing, that have been demolished. In town. Yes, but my heart remains here, and I think it gave me a wonderful grounding about values in life too, you know, friendship, mm-hmm. and giving, volunteering, and how important that is to all organizations. Most of them wouldn't exist, you know, a nonprofit organization wouldn't exist if it wasn't for volunteers, and like you, and like Greg, and all the people here. So I'm honored to have been part of this oral history, and I hope I've managed to impart some of the delights of my life here, and how much it has meant to me, and I hope you have lots of other people that are going to be interviewed too.
Well, thank you so much for your participation. You have imparted the delights of living in Newmarket to us, and I hope you will continue your interest in the town and in the Historical Society. We certainly appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Terry. I plan to. It's been a delight for me.